So you have a new book, What You Do Is Who You Are, and you do a great job of defining what corporate culture really is and what it isn't. Can you help me understand that?
Sure, you know, and this was a kind of struggle that I had as CEO because everybody is like, Ben, pay attention to your culture. I'm like, great, how do I do that? And that was basically the end of the advice. So it was kind of, okay, you got to figure it out. And it turns out that a lot of what you kind of will get from an HR consultant or whatever, it turns out to be almost the opposite of what you want. So they'll be like, well, you know, have an offsite and everybody will like pitch in on the values and then you can put it in people's performance reviews. But culture ends up being all the things that people do when you're not there and when you're not looking. So it's, oh, did they return that phone call today or next week or not at all? Did they show up to the meeting on time? Did they work till 5 o'clock or 8 o'clock? You know, in a business deal, was it about the price or about the partnership? And all these kind of little behaviors that you have, which, okay, you put in the performance review, you don't know if they made that. They don't know if they returned the phone call. You don't even know if they got the phone call. And so that's what culture ends up being. It's all the kind of things that you do. And so the reason for the title of the book comes from the Bushido, which says, a culture is not a set of beliefs, it's a set of actions. And the book is about how do you get the actions to be what you want them to be.
And how do you get the actions to be? If it's not going to an offsite and writing down a list of rules, how do you pick what the rules are that define those priorities and how do you get people to follow them?
It's very subtle. It's little things that move the culture. And I like that term, move the culture, as opposed to set the culture, because you're not really dictating it. So I'll give you just a little example that we use at the office. So one thing that all venture capitalists kind of aspire to or say they are, they all value the entrepreneur. Well, we love the entrepreneur, we respect the entrepreneur, we respect the process. But then if you get into the actual dynamic of the business, what happens, it's, oh, you need money? I have money. You gotta come to see me and then I'll decide if I'm gonna give you the money. And so then at that point, like, who's the big person, who's the little person? And then you see it in their behavior. They show up 30 minutes late. It's kind of legendary if you're an entrepreneur. They're not gonna invest in you, they just ghost you. They don't even like respond. So we had that kind of theoretical problem when we started the firm, and that we wanted to respect the entrepreneurial process and how hard it was, but how do you do that? And so I said, you know, a little trick, which was a rule that kind of upset and shocked people, which is if you're late for a meeting with an entrepreneur, you pay a fine, $10 a minute. And oh, you had to go to the bathroom, you're 5 minutes late, great, $50. Oh, you had a really important business call, you're 10 minutes late, $100. And they're like, Ben, why am I paying you to work here? Like, that doesn't seem fair. I'm like, because I need you to understand how hard it is to build a company. And I need you to understand so much that you plan to be on time. And I know that business call was important. I know you had to go to the bathroom, but like if it was your wedding, you wouldn't have been late. So like, it's gotta be that important to you. And so that kind of thing, every time they go to a meeting, people have to think about that. Why am I on time? Oh, I'm on time because it's really hard to build a company.
And for every company, a different culture might be more appropriate than another. Can you give me some examples of cultures that work very well for specific companies and wouldn't work for others?
Sure. Well, like Amazon, who has, you know, one of the strongest cultures in the technology business, has this thing about frugality. And they said it so hard, like in the old days when you got to Amazon, you got a desk that was made out of a door and some 2x4s. Like, we can't even afford desks. Like, that's how cheap we are. And that really went with their strategy of being the low price, basically the low cost provider always. So the promise to their customers was, you go to Amazon, you don't have to price check because we're going to be the lowest. Contrast that with Apple. They just built like a $5 billion campus. And I don't know what the doorknobs cost, but they're probably thousands of dollars, you know, that kind of thing. Why is that? Well, they're all about high design, beautiful products, these kinds of things. They're never going to have a cultural value of frugality. It wouldn't make sense for them. And you know, Apple's products are a lot more beautiful than Amazon's products, and Amazon's products are a lot cheaper. And so which one do you want? And your culture has to support your business strategy. And that's why, you know, every culture isn't right for every company. And there's not, you know, it's not a good culture or a bad culture. It's a cohesive culture that achieves the goal that you want.
And a lot of your examples come from Silicon Valley. Is there anything you feel like Wall Street could learn from the experimentation around culture in Silicon Valley?
Yeah, I mean, I think that Wall Street culture is, you know, anytime you have an industry that's really old, you get kind of cultural things that last and you don't know why. We have one of these things in Silicon Valley, which is, so most of Silicon Valley culture was set years ago by a company called Intel. And Intel had this amazing founder, Bob Noyce, who really transformed the culture of business from, you know, basically the East Coast super hierarchical, the executives have their own special parking spots and so forth, to kind of a more egalitarian, meritocratic culture. And the idea was that the best engineers were as important to the business as the top executives. And so they wanted to make sure they heard the best engineers and their voice got told and all that. So they had casual dress and cubicles and all this stuff. So we all have all that in Silicon Valley still, but everybody's forgotten why. And so, you know, it's like you're not coming to work like in your pajamas because like we want you wearing your pajamas at work. You're coming, you want people to kind of dress the same so there's not a hierarchy of fashion and all that kind of thing. And I think Wall Street has a lot of those old things as well. I mean, we saw in Hollywood, right, which is kind of the origin of the whole Me Too movement, a lot of that came from the very early days, and they just left it in the culture. I mean, it was never a good idea, but then, like, they kept it, and it was never a good idea. And so things that get in the culture, unless you really look at them and say, okay, we have to change, the inertia will keep them there.
And you've had a long career as an entrepreneur as well as an investor. What is the biggest mistakes that you've made when it comes to culture, or a single one?
Oh, I made so many. But the kind of the one that I remember the most is I thought, well, if I lead by example, then everybody will just follow my culture, which isn't true at all. Because, look, people come in with their own cultures. You know, there's a whole subcultures going on all over the company. And as the company grows, they don't even know you. And I'll never forget, I had this, you know, I felt like, you know, I was generally an honest person, like nobody's 100% honest, but pretty honest. And I had a guy running products who was just like always lying, you know, and telling everybody just false promises, this and that, you know, hiring people, telling them we're going to be this, telling customers that. And I had no idea. And then like somebody mentioned me, you know, like, yeah, everybody's always just like telling these like fantastical stories in that area. And I'm like, no, that can't be, like, no way. You know, I was just shocked. Like, how could they be lying all the time? I don't lie all the time. And it was just, yeah, that was a culture that he had come from another company that was like into over-marketing. And so if you don't set the culture, like the culture just is what it is. It's not how you behave necessarily.
When you're doing due diligence on a potential investment, are there red flags you look for? You said that it's hard to identify a culture just walking into a place, but is there anything you can look for that's an indication of if something is a good culture or bad culture?
I mean, I think that, you know, you can get clues. It's very hard, like in our position, you know, in the kind of time frame that we have to examine a company. But one thing, you know, it's very rare that you would have like the founder or the CEO make stuff up or like kind of exaggerate or fake it till they make it or whatever they call lying these days without the whole company being like that, because that is something that is tends to be contagious. So, you know, you can clue in on that. There are things where, you know, you have multiple founders in the meeting and like some of them are afraid to say what they think, like even in a pitch meeting and these kinds of things. So, you know, those are all kind of cultural cues and aspects. But I would say this, very few founders have a great sense of how to build a culture. So it's something that they learn as they go. You know, it's not like we don't see people come in or who are cultural masters like Toussaint Louverture or something like that.
If you look at a company like WeWork, where they had a lot of culture and some of it was very beneficial to what they built and some of it ended up not being as much.
Sure.
So what is your assessment of something like that?
Well, you know, that's one of those ones where a lot of time you're strength is your weakness. They had this amazingly optimistic culture. Adam had convinced the whole company they could do anything and they were going to change the future of work and so forth. And that had a great power to it. You know, not only in like raising a lot of money, but also the quality of the people they were able to hire, the kind of momentum they had behind the whole thing. And, you know, people who kind of partnered with them and worked with them all kind of started to believe in because it was such a powerful optimism. But I think that, you know, when you are that optimistic generally, and I don't know intimately, but it's really easy for people to shut down bad news. So, you know, we're changing the world, we're doing this, everything is going to go well, like, you know, we said it, it's going to happen. And then somebody goes, well, you know, like, our accounting systems really aren't like up to speed with the business. They're kind of like we can't even keep track of what we're doing here, no, it's going to be fine. Like that there is really problematic, because there's no way that the issues that came out in WeWork weren't known in WeWork, but somehow that information didn't travel to where it needed to go. And you know, that is often like a cultural problem about, can you hear the bad news as well as the good news?
You don't seem to shy away from discussions about race and diversity, and it seems we're in a moment right now where there's a lack of diversity in leadership in many companies, but there's a lot of diversity among employees who are starting to ask questions very blatantly to managers. What do you suggest that managers say, and what should they do in order to address that?
Yeah, well, look, I think that people are approaching diversity from a weird perspective, which is they're, you know, like from a pressure, like they're getting pressure from the press or from their employees or so forth, and they're not sure what they should do, but what they really want is like the sticker that says, I'm not sexist, I'm not racist or whatever, or I love women, or I, you know, I love Hispanic people. Or, and the problem with that is if you start from there, then you're actually solving the wrong problem, and that what you're trying to do is get to some numerical breakdown or this or that or the other, when the real thing is people want their talent to be seen and their talent to be valued. Let me give you kind of a story about this that made it very clear for me. So my friend Steve Stout, who used to be president of Sony Urban Music, and he calls me up one day and he goes, Ben, I used to be president of Sony Urban Music. And I'm like, Steve, I know that. But that's his personality. Mm-hmm. He tells me stuff I already know when he wants to really me to really listen. And I go, I already know that. He says, yeah, but it wasn't urban music. It was black music, but we had to call it urban music because black music, that would have been racist. And I was like, well, that's kind of silly. And he goes, no. That wasn't the really dumb thing. The really dumb thing was, because we called it urban music, I could only market in cities. And I was like, wow, that's really weird. He's like, yeah, like there are no black people living in rural areas. I was like, that's so stupid. And he goes, no, you're not listening to me, Ben. I was president of Sony Urban Music. Sony Urban Music, I had Michael Jackson. What white people don't like Michael Jackson? It wasn't black music, it was music. And because they made me market it as black music, we cut off the market. And I was like, wow, that's exactly how we do it in corporate America, but we call it, you know, it's urban HR. We call it the diversity department. And so rather than it being talent, it's female talent, Hispanic talent, African-American talent, but no, it's talent. And the problem is we're not able to see the talent because it's not the same talent that we have necessarily. And so how it works in a company is, and why people care about the leadership is, oh, you've got a woman running a group, guess what, there's a lot of women in it. You have a white man running a group, a lot of white men in it. Asian person, a lot of Asian people. And that whole dynamic perpetuates because why? I know what I'm good at. I value it highly, and I can test for it in an interview. And specifically, I can't see what I don't have. And that is what feels most uninclusive once you get there, once you actually get the job. And so we had this problem at our firm very early on. We had an Asian guy running research, everybody was Asian, woman running marketing, everybody's a woman, like so forth. So I'm trying to diagnose this. And I go to our head of marketing, genius woman, Margaret Wenmachers, and I say, Margaret, what is in your hiring criteria where no men have been able to get the job? And she says, helpfulness. And I'm like, snap. I don't know a lot of helpful men. But the more important thing about that was we're a venture capital firm. We're in the services industry. What job did we have where being able to anticipate somebody's needs before they even said anything wouldn't be an incredible asset to the company? But we didn't have that criteria in most of our profiles. We couldn't see it. I couldn't see it. I was talent blind.
And you draw, especially in this book, lessons from all different cultures and all different stories. What inspired you to look across history and across cultures that you're not a part of? And have you received any pushback from, you know, going across, you know, all, you know, you're interested in rap and, yes, and all sorts of different history?
I'm not Haitian, but I wrote about the Haitian Revolution, and I'm not, I wasn't in prison, but I wrote about prison. And I'm not an ancient samurai warrior, but I wrote about that and so forth. And I think the subject matter was treated with the kind of the right lens, with the right amount of respect and honesty that I haven't gotten a lot of, you know, I haven't gotten negative pushback. It's been mostly supportive. But I think it's been very important. Each one of those is kind of critical in what it does. So for example, people go, well, why are you talking about prison culture? Prison culture, it turns out, is very instructive because if you're hiring into a company, people come with a lot of kind of cultural building blocks. So, you know, they know how to show up for an interview and dress correctly. They know how to be on time. They know how to do certain things. They're kind of have cultural things that you can build on. In prison, you're really starting from first principles. Like, people come in with very, very little. And so kind of going through how Shaka Sangor built that culture, built the prison gang culture, and then changed it is, you know, one of the most illuminating things that I've ever kind of been through as a process, understanding that in any kind of cultural example I've seen. So it turns out to be, I think, very effective.
Looking at Andreessen Horowitz's portfolio, is mm-hmm. there a favorite bet that you have in there that you're really excited about what the company is doing that the media isn't covering already, or, you know?
Yeah, so, you know, one of the companies that I'm personally involved in that is an amazing company that I think the media, because it's infrastructure, doesn't pay much attention to is a company called Databricks, which basically is the infrastructure for AI. It's kind of the big data database. And they're solving an amazing set of problems from, you know, people working with it to cure cancer to people doing threat detection on kind of massive attacks from state actors and these kinds of things. And it's just, I would say, really incredible what you can do if you can actually harness the mass amount of data that's out there.
Are you still interested in Bitcoin at all?
Yes. Oh, yeah. Well, not just Bitcoin.
Sorry.
The whole cryptocurrency.
Yes.
So, cryptocurrency blockchain technologies are, we think, going to be transformational in the future. And the reason is it's a new computing platform is the way to think about it. And it's deceptive because, like other new computing platforms, it's worse in every way except for one. So if you think about the smartphone, like, it was a way worse computer than the PC. Like, try doing a spreadsheet on that. It doesn't have a keyboard. The screen is tiny. And so if you looked at it through that lens, it was terrible. But it had a GPS and a camera on it, so you could build Instagram. You could build, you know, Lyft. You could never build that on a PC. You'll never build it on a PC. Blockchain's like that. The new feature is trust, meaning I don't have to trust a company or the government or my lawyer or anything. I can just trust the game theoretic and mathematical properties of the platform, and then I can program new things. And there's been, you know, the early things, Bitcoin is a great example. I can program money. People go, oh, Bitcoin, da 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 da, it's this, it's that, it's not a real currency. The thing is 10 years old, and it's got $170 billion in value, and, like, it's just software. It's just a software program with, like, four guys working on it. And so you go, well, how is that? It's because it's got trust, and people trust it as a store of value. And that's an amazing thing. And if you think about, you know, being able to program everything from a new judiciary to, you know, art. So art now exists in it's all virtual, right? Art is virtual. Like, how much does the canvas and the paint cost? Almost nothing. But because you know that was painted by Basquiat, no one else has one, it's worth a lot of money. What if you could do that digitally? Well, that's something that you can do with this kind of technology. So there's all kinds of amazing possibilities. Early days, but we're fired up about it.